In this video, we'll explore the process of integrating web API methods into a .NET MAUI application. In our previous video, we created an ASP.NET Core web API project, specifically creating a product controller to manage our application's functionality. We have successfully implemented the necessary methods for performing CRUD operations, encompassing create, read, update, and delete operations. Within our API, you'll find two distinct HTTP GET methods, one for retrieving all the products and another for fetching a specific product by its unique identifier. Furthermore, we have included methods to facilitate the creation, modification, and removal of products. To facilitate this integration, we have developed a class library project known as demo.api client, which will help us in consuming these API methods. Inside the demo API client service class, we have created the methods to interact with the API using the HTTP client object. In our previous video, we have also created a Blazor application designed to efficiently leverage these API methods for managing product data. Now, let's delve into the process of implementing this same functionality in a .NET MAUI application. First, we'll initiate the creation of a new .NET MAUI project within our existing solution. Next, I'll apply a filter to narrow down the options and focus on the available MAUI project templates. Among the choices, you'll find the .NET MAUI app template, which I'll select for our project. To maintain a structured project hierarchy, we'll house this new project within a folder named Presentation. For the project's name, we'll label it as demo.maui API consumer. With the details in place, let's proceed and create the project. We now have the project files displayed in the Solution Explorer. First, I'll create a Pages folder where we'll organize our content pages. Let's proceed by relocating the auto-generated content page labeled Main Page into this newly created Pages folder. With Main Page now in place, we'll begin customizing it to suit our specific requirements by clearing its existing elements. Additionally, within the mainpage.xaml.cs class, we can safely remove any unnecessary objects and methods. Following this, we'll establish a project reference to our API client class library, enabling us to leverage its methods within this .NET MAUI application. You can spot the added library in the projects folder within the Solution Explorer. Our next step involves navigating to the MAUI-program.cs class to set up dependency injection. To achieve this, we'll integrate the demo API client service into the dependency services, leveraging the add demo API client service method that we created in the previous video. All we need to do is import the necessary namespace to make it accessible. Now, let's configure the API base address. Since we'll be running the API project on this machine for testing purposes, we can use 10.0.2.2, which serves as a reference to the host machine when using in the Android emulator. The API application will be listening on port number 5015 for incoming requests. In addition, we'll include the main page as a dependency using the addTransient method. Moving on, we'll open the app.xaml.cs file and designate the main page property. With the main page now established as a dependency, we can retrieve the object through the constructor and set it as the initial page. Now, within the mainpage.xaml file, I'll provide a straightforward design to display the list of products. Within this layout, you'll notice two buttons, one for adding a new product and another for displaying the existing products. We have also incorporated a list view control to showcase the added products. As the design details are already covered in our .NET MAUI tutorial playlist, I won't delve into extensive explanations here. I'll proceed to add the click events for both the buttons, and we'll be implementing these functionalities shortly. Additionally, I'm incorporating the item tapped event for the list view control. When a user taps on an item, we can present options such as edit and delete. As we transition to the main page.xaml.cs class, you will see the newly created methods. Our next step involves the creation of a new content page, which will facilitate the addition or editing of products. I've named this page Add Edit Product, and I've removed the automatically generated vertical stack layout and the label. Within the Add Edit Product page, I've organized the necessary controls for adding and editing a product. This includes entry fields for the product code, name, and price. We have also introduced two buttons, one for saving the product and another for canceling the operation. Let's proceed to create the button click events right here in this page. Let's begin the implementation by focusing on the Add Edit Product page. First, we'll declare a private read-only object of our API client service, which is a component of our API client library. Additionally, we'll declare a private object for the product, which we'll be passing from the main page when editing a product. We'll obtain the API client service object from the class constructor. And similarly, we'll acquire the product object from the class constructor itself, which will be passed from the main page. Next, we'll proceed to instantiate our private objects using the received objects. In addition, I'm introducing a method called loadProductDetails, which we'll invoke when editing a product. This allows the users to view the existing product details in the corresponding entry fields. Initially, we'll perform a check to determine whether the product object is null. If the user is attempting to add a new product, the product object will be null and there won't be a need to populate any data in the entry fields. However, if the product object is not null, we'll populate the values for code, name, and price from the product object. Moving forward, we'll proceed with the implementation of the save functionality. Once again, we'll check whether the product object is null. If it is null, this signifies that we need to add a new product. On the other hand, if it is not null, we must update the existing product. After successfully saving the details, we'll close the page by utilizing the popModelAsync method. If the product object is null, we can easily invoke the saveProduct method of our API client service and provide a new product object as the parameter. We'll assign the properties by extracting the product code, name, and price from their respective entry fields. For the update operation, we'll call the updateProduct method. In the product properties, it's crucial to assign the product ID as the API relies on the identifier for updating the product. The remaining properties can be assigned in the same manner as when adding a new product. To handle the cancel button, we can straightforwardly close the content page by utilizing the popModelAsync method. With these implementations in place, we have successfully completed the necessary functionality for this content page. Now, let's shift our focus on the main page. Similarly, within the main page, we'll create a private read-only object of our API client service. As we have successfully injected the dependency, we can readily acquire API client service object from the class constructor. When the user clicks the Add button, we'll seamlessly navigate them to our Add Edit Product page. To facilitate this transition, we'll provide the necessary parameters. The initial parameter will be the API client service, and the second one will be the product object. In this case, since the user is attempting to add a new product, we can pass null as the product parameter. Before we proceed with the implementation of the Show Products button click event, let's first create a new method named LoadProducts. Within this method, we'll retrieve all the products from the API client service using the GetProducts method. Subsequently, we can assign the item source property of the ListView control. Finally, we can invoke the newly created LoadProducts method when the user clicks the Show Products button. Next, we'll proceed to implement the functionality when a list item is tapped. We can retrieve the tapped product from the events item property, but it's currently of type object. To address this, we'll cast it to the product type. Following this, we'll display an action sheet from which the user can select the desired action. We'll set the title as action and designate the cancel button text as cancel. For the destructive button text, we won't specify any value as it's not needed. Now, we'll define the actions to be displayed. In this case, we require two actions, edit and delete. Following the user's selection of an action, we'll execute different tasks. Let's create a switch case to handle two distinct cases, edit and delete. If the user opts for edit action, we'll seamlessly navigate them to the Add Edit Product page. Here, we'll pass the API client service and the product object. On the other hand, if the user chooses the delete action, we'll initiate the product deletion using the delete product method in our API client service. We'll also call the load products method to refresh the list. With these implementations, we have successfully completed our development process. Before we conclude, let's proceed to test the application by running it in the emulator. Since we need to run both the API and Android applications together, I have chosen multiple startup projects in the solution properties. Let's go ahead and run the application. Great! It appears that both the API and Android applications have loaded successfully. As you click the Show Products button, you can see that we are able to view the products that are already present in the database. Just to verify, I'll run a select query in SQL Management Studio, and you can observe that we indeed have the same listed products in our database. Now, let's attempt to add a new product. I am inputting the product code, name, and price values, and clicking the Save button has seamlessly navigated us back to the main page. Let's refresh the list, and you'll notice the newly added product is now included in the list. Now, when tapping on an item, you can see the action sheet displayed. Let's proceed with the editing process. It appears that we missed a crucial step. The product details are supposed to load into the fields. Let's navigate to the Add Edit Product XAML.cs class to rectify this. We actually missed calling the Load Products method in the class constructor. Let me provide that. I am running the projects again with both applications running now. I'll attempt to edit the product. You can observe that the product details are now correctly populated. I'll modify the values, and when I click the Save button, it will seamlessly navigate us back to the main page. Upon refreshing the list, you can see the modified values have been successfully updated. Now, let's proceed to delete a product, and you can observe that the product has been removed from the list. It's evident that all the API methods are functioning seamlessly and the application is working perfectly. In summary, we have learned how to connect our .NET MAUI app to a web API. We have covered everything from adding and editing products to listing, updating and deleting them. If you found this video helpful, please like, share and subscribe the channel. Thanks for watching and stay tuned for more tutorials.